just want you to turn to a few scriptures here. I just wanted to those of you that really have the ministry, the ministry at heart, there are some things that I feel that we could utilize to make a greater impact on those that we are reaching. I have a specific reference to in years past when people that were seeking certain blessings from the Lord, sometimes people were the Holy Spirit, sometimes they were seeking the Holy Spirit for many years. We call them chronic cases. And it was a really amazing Monday night, a young lady, so I think it was Brother Jeremy's wife to be. Amen. She was, they were on the back seat Monday night, and the anointing began to work back there, and before the service was over, without even instructing her, she was praying in the Spirit. Amen. But it's sometimes when the anointing is at a certain level, sometimes people can receive without even receiving instructions. How many remember when Peter was called to preach at Cornelius' house? And Peter was just preaching his sermon. And while before he could finish his sermon, people couldn't wait. Amen. They just started what? They started blabbing it out.
All right.
They got filled with the Holy Spirit before Peter could even have the altar call. Mm-hmm. So I do believe that if we could set the right environment and pray in the Spirit more and rejoice in the Lord a lot more and wipe away these sad looking faces. Saints have these sad looking faces. It's because they're not really, you know, giving themselves in prayer and in walking in fellowship like they should. Amen. So we want to try to pray all of that coldness and that lukewarmness and that spiritual indifference off of people. Because I've seen people seek for the Holy Ghost for 20 or 30 years. And I think a lot of it has to do, the reason why I want to begin to focus more on communicating to people how eager and how much God is full of eager yearning. God really wants to bless people much more than they have ever envisioned. But many times it is very difficult for God to bless us and go against His word if we are not doing our what God tells us to do. You know, one day He says to do delight in Him, He'll give you what He desires of your heart. But there are some laws God can't override to bless us, even though He yearns to do it. He wants to do it really, really bad. And I think that a lot of times when we've had people that were very difficult to get filled with the Holy Spirit, many times they didn't see God as somebody that was really compassionate, somebody that was yearning or desiring to bless them more than they were desiring to be blessed. They looked upon God as an austere person, a hard person, a person that was waiting, looking for the slightest thing to condemn them or to judge them or to strike them down. And there's one side of God that in some circles in the past where God is looked more upon as a God of judgment, a God that will get you if you don't, you know, do this or that. But the compassionate heart of God, which is the greatest attribute of God, is something that is not magnified. Is not magnified. And I think that if we could magnify God's goodness and God's mercy and God's love and the fact that God really wants to bless us, not just filling us with the Holy Spirit or saving us or healing us, but God really wants to bless us financially. And He yearns to do it. He wants to do it really, really bad. Amen. But the things that we fail to do sometimes, what? It just hinders God from blessing us. Amen. So one thing that I wanted to do, when we begin to work with people, I want us to really begin to focus upon God's compassion, God's mercy. And when you begin to, for instance, like in healing, you can go back to the Old Testament and you can look all through the New Testament and look and point out all of the instances in which the Lord really had mercy on people. And actually, He made it possible, even under the Old Covenant, for people to be healed of all of their diseases and even to be forgiven of all of their iniquities. There were provisions that He made for people under the Old Covenant to be forgiven of their sins, or sins to be not remitted, but those sins were covered under the Old Covenant. In other words, God didn't hold them against them in terms of withholding His, you know, His blessings and His love from them. So when we began to minister to people, even in getting them filled with the Holy Spirit, one barrier you have to overcome is that sometimes people have heard that it's not God's will for people to be filled with the Holy Ghost today, or to speak in tongues, or to operate in any gifts, because all of that went out under the during the dispensation of the apostles. So in other words, God is not as compassionate as He used to be. See, and the Bible says Jesus Christ is the same what?
Yesterday,
today, and forever. But it seemed like all of the compassion, all of the mercy, you know, all of the things that shows us plainly, and this is probably the most conspicuous statement throughout the whole Bible, that God is love, God is merciful, God is full of grace, God is for us, God delighteth in mercy. God is good and His mercy and do it forever.
Amen.
But a lot of the, I guess, the boldness that people have when they begin to approach God is kind of watered down, because many times people, we don't exalt the Lord, amen, to the extent where He's still the same Jesus, as He's still the same healer, the same Savior, the same keeper, the same baptizer in the Holy Ghost that He has always been in yesteryear. Amen. So the only way that we can get people receiving a lot easier is that we have to magnify God's compassion. We have to magnify it. And that was one of the things I was trying to get over Sunday, is that F.F. Bosworth, in his Christ the Healer book, and this is what all of the faith teachers, you know, usually kind of use as the textbook for healing. They said that if you want people's faith to rise mountaintop high, he says, don't talk about God's power. Don't talk about God's power, you know, how powerful God is. Because the Bible never said anything about God is, you know, God is powerful. Mm-hmm. Although, you know, we know He's powerful, mm-hmm. but God, the Word does say God is what? Love.
Yes.
Right. God is what? Full of compassion.
Yes.
He said, whenever you really begin to magnify the compassion and then go back, begin to relate scripture after scripture, giving illustrations and examples of how God moved with compassion. You know, even among the children of Israel, mm-hmm. I mean, those people did like 1,000 and 10,000, 10,000 things, brother, over and over and over and over.
Right.
Amen. Of course, he punched them, you know, ended up in captivity under heathen kings and all that. But whenever they cried out to God and got serious and turned their hearts, there are certain conditions that God will always hear your cry. He will always respond to your need.
Yes.
But there are certain, you know, criteria that God has set on, amen, his compassion. Amen. He's not going to just arbitrarily just pull out his mercy without certain conditions being met, or he's not going to violate his word to do it.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. But we can see his love all through the scripture, and many times. So if we could point people to examples of Jesus moved with compassion. How many remember when the leper came? Amen. He was a leper, you know, and these were people that were despised and ostracized. They had to go out, you know, separate and live separate from everybody else. And this person was approaching Jesus, and everywhere a leper went, he had to cry out that, you know, I'm a leper, I'm a leper, I'm a leper. And people just began to run and flee and get out of the way and avoid him. And, amen. But this leper came to Jesus, and he said, amen, he says, Lord, if it's your will, I want to be healed. And Jesus, the Bible says he was moved with compassion toward him.
Yeah.
Then he told the leper, he said, I will, it's my will for you to be healed.
Mm-hmm.
And then he stretched forth a hand and touched the leper. Amen. And the leprosy departed. We can find many instances where Christ's compassion was released to people that were in dire straits and people that were in situations that probably hopeless situations where nobody would even dare to reach out and to offer any type of help or any type of hope to them at all. But Jesus always reached out, and he was always moved with compassion. I may remember the guy that was in the cemetery.
Amen.
Amen. That's about as worse as you can get. Amen. He was in the cemetery, he lived in the tomb.
Amen.
Anybody living in the tomb, what could you say about him?
Crazy.
I mean, he was full of devils and demons, and he was cutting himself, and they tried to bind him with chains, and every time they bind them, devils were real strong. He would just break them in two, just like a piece of paper. And he was mad. And that man, when Jesus came through there, Jesus, he was moved with compassion. He took up some time with him. And he just began to dialogue with him. And after he talked to this man and ministered to him, then he told the man, he cast out those demons, and those demons went, it was how many of them? Thousands of them. And all, amen. And they went out of that man. I don't know how many legions of demons. And they went out of that man, and they went over on the next farm and got in those pigs. And all those pigs ran down in the river. And all of them were drowned. Amen. But one thing that Jesus told that man after he was healed and completely, the Bible says after Jesus cast all of those spirits out of him, that man was right there. He was in his right mind.
Amen.
All of those evil spirits and all of those demons that was binding him and controlling him, those things had all, amen, praise God, been broken off his life.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus told that man, he said, go to all of your friends, amen, and tell them how the Lord has had compassion on you.
Mm-hmm.
So he went around to all of his friends. He said, I was in the tomb for 25 years.
Mm-hmm.
I lived in the tomb tonight. Amen. I operated in the tomb. I was full of devils and demons, and I would, I was acting like a madman. I was out of my mind. I was crazy, and Jesus came through the tomb. Came through the tomb one
Amen.
Day,
Thank you, Lord.
And he prayed and reached out.
Yes.
And helped me and blessed me and delivered me. And that man went and told so many folk until a whole city, in the capital, the whole city came out.
Mm-hmm.
And they brought all of their dumb, lame, maimed, like everybody.
Yes.
And the Bible says Jesus, you know, healed them all.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Amen. So Jesus is really more concerned about us. And I think that even when we're dealing with people to receive the Holy Spirit, I remember in Arkansas, I was in a meeting, and it was a guy that was a pharmacist. He came, he had been saved, but he hadn't been filled with the Holy Spirit. And he was telling me that the Holy Spirit was not for him because, you know, God doesn't always fill everybody with the Holy Spirit. So it wasn't for him to be filled. So I shared the word with him, and that brother was filled with the Holy Spirit. But sometimes people are very difficult to, it's difficult for them to receive when they have a wrong attitude, a wrong idea, the wrong opinion.
Yes.
About God's love. Mm-hmm. And God's concern for them.
Yes.
And until people feel like, you know, God ain't got his head over your neck, even just waiting for you to what?
Mess up. Mm-hmm.
So he can what? Cut your head, neck off.
Yeah.
And when we can project him as a good God, loving God, God that's full of eager yearning, God that really, the scripture says, he's running to and fro, his eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth.
Amen.
He's looking for those hearts that's perfect before him.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. In other words, he's looking for hearts that will let him or permit him to do what he wants to do real bad.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing that we got to learn, and we got to get a lot more excited about the provision that God has already made available. You know, everything that we are liking and needing is already provided us.
Amen.
I mean, we're already blessed.
Amen.
And one thing that holds us up is that we don't have too much enthusiasm about the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Some of us, you know, we don't open up and praise the Lord like we should. And see, that's a condition for these blessings to be released. Although God has these, all these blessings hanging right over our head.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just think about the cloud, the entire universe. Suppose it was just like, full of blessings.
Mm-hmm.
In some type of plastic or something.
Mm-hmm.
And all of these things were just hanging right over the universe.
Mm-hmm.
All over. Everywhere you say, oh man, God's blessings are everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, look at all these blessings. But actually the blessings are right. I mean, they've already been released. It's God is just waiting to release them into our lives.
Amen.
Amen. And if all of those blessings were in water and that water was in some type of plastic, you know, where it could be contained, amen, all you would have to do is put a little hole, amen, punch a big hole in it, and those blessings would start what?
Rolling.
Right. Amen, all over you, overtaking you.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Praise
thank
God.
Lord.
But so it's going to take something to release the blessings that God wants to release upon us really, really bad.
Amen.
So I just had a few scriptures. The scripture, Micah 7:18, it says, he delighteth in mercy. What does that mean to you? God delights in mercy. God delighteth in mercy. Amen. We know that God delighteth in mercy, but sometimes his mercy can't reach us, his blessings can't reach us, because many times let those blessings, we hinder blessings, amen, sometimes because of the things that we fail to do. And that's one reason why I made a decision, a quality decision. Y'all can be as quiet as y'all want to. I'm going to open my mouth and praise God, amen, as loud as I can, because when I break and release my spirit, then the blessing of the Lord begins to pour into my life.
Amen.
I feel like a Superman after I howl out loud and Amen, and God, amen, praise God, get released and get broken. Amen, I feel like a Superman. And that's the key to blessings, we gotta open up and let go and let God. We have to, amen, prepare the way for God to, amen, release these blessings, to do what he wants to do real bad. All right, he delighted in mercy. Amen. I want somebody to act like you're delighted in something. We're supposed to be delighted in the Lord tonight. Somebody act like you're delighted in something. Let me see, how do we have any actors here tonight? All right. Now, let me ask you this. God said, well, I got $500 for you, right? Now I'll give you $500. If you can delight yourself in me, if you can prove to me that you are genuinely delight yourself in me, amen. How many would be willing to delight in the Lord the way he wanted you to delight in him? You think everybody would be willing to do it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Amen. For money, of course. All right, well, God delighteth in mercy, so we know that God is really excited about releasing his mercy, his love, and meeting all of your needs. You know, all of the needs that we're speaking about, these needs range from all of these Jehovah's will tell you the Lord is always there. Amen. That's one of the blessings that God has already covenanted with us, and he has promised to be with us always, even until the end of the world. And mm-hmm. God's presence is always with us through the Holy Spirit that we have received when we were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Everywhere you go, God's presence goes with you, because now he lives on the inside of you. Yes. That's the reason why he can be a perfect shepherd for you. A shepherd is a person that takes care of every single need that the sheep has. Yes. Amen. He's always what? There, watching, mm-hmm. guiding, leading, protecting, yes. blessing, feeding, yes. nourishing them. Yes. He's always there. Amen. So the Lord has promised to always be there. Amen. That is a blessing. That's a big blessing. How many would like to go through this world being all alone? Amen. Nobody to comfort you, nobody to guide you, nobody to lead you, nobody to fight for you. Amen. Nobody to...